What's going on, Crossing? How are you? I have a question as we get rolling. How many of you have never heard that song before? Okay, so yeah, yes, I knew there was going to be people who had never heard that song before. We played last week. What did we play last week? Oh, we played Led Zeppelin last week. Everybody knows Led Zeppelin. We play an old church song at the Crossing. We were like, what is that? That's kind of normal for the Crossing. Was it good though? Yeah. That was good. Okay, we are in this series called Havin Church. Everybody say Havin Church. And the point of the series is we understand why we still do church. We've started last week by talking about the book of Acts, Acts chapter 1. We kind of looked at the book of Acts, Acts chapter 1 a little bit. Acts was written by a guy named what? Luke. Luke wrote the book of Acts. Everybody say Luke. Luke. And what he was trying to do was describe as a doctor what the first church looked like. Today we're going to look at Acts chapter 2. So if you have your note sheet, can you get it out? Hold it up for me. Okay, so we're going to start by being old school again. We're going to stand for the reading of Scripture. So can you stand to your feet? Every so often, we just invite you at this church to stand for the Word of God. And so, like, I don't really stand for the reading of anything else, but I'll stand for the reading of Scripture. You know, actually, I shouldn't say not anything else. I stand for the national anthem, all that kind of stuff too. But like, this is, you know what I'm saying? But this is kind of good. This is like you are honoring Scripture in the same way you stand for the national anthem. Last night, I was at a baseball game, put our hand over our heart. National anthem was played. So you're in standing for the Scriptures right now, you're saying, this matters to me. Everybody say, this matters to me. Okay, so this is Acts chapter 2. We're going to read verses 36 and following. It goes like this. It says, so let everyone, by the way, this is Peter preaching a sermon, and Luke is recording it. Just like you're taking notes tonight, probably in the service, Luke was taking notes about the first church sermon, and this was the first church sermon as it was preached. This is how Luke records it. So let everyone in Israel know for certain that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, to be both Lord and Messiah. Everybody say Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus' words pierced their hearts. That should happen in church. Your hearts should be pierced. Like at some point or another, boom, that was the thought that was for me in a worship service. The whole thing can't be for you, but at some moment in this deal, boom, something's going to be for you. And they said to each other and to the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? Now that we heard this, now that we felt this, what do we do next? Peter replied, each of you must repent. Everybody say repent. Of your sins and turn to God and be in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. We talked about that verse last week. Then you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is for you and for your
children.
Whoa, it's not just for you. So parents, it's not just for you to come to church. And if kids feel like coming to church, this promise is for you and for your That's interesting. This promise for you and for your children, even for the Gentiles and all who have called on the name of the Lord our God. Then Peter continued preaching for a long time, and everybody said, amen. Preaching is good when it's long. Come on, say amen.
Amen.
Preaching is good when it's long. I'm just telling you right now. That's why I like this church. Okay. I get to do the preaching, that's why. He preached for a long time, strongly urging all his listeners, save yourselves from this crooked generation. Those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day about how many? 3,000 people. First day of that was the first church service. 3,000 people become believers. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the sharing of meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. And a deep sense of awe came over all of them, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. All the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. Whoa. They sold their property and their possessions. Oh, that's uncommon. And shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together in the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day, the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being
saved.
All right, you've heard the word of God. Let's pray and then we'll talk about it. Jesus, I'm so grateful for every life in this room and those watching on the internet right now. I pray that as we look at Havin Church and why it matters and what's the point, what's the purpose, what are we here for, that this would go deep into our hearts. May we understand the first church, who they were, what they were about, and then may we not try to be like them, but be like you, Jesus. Jesus, change our hearts to be like you. And in becoming like you, may we live out your calling for your church. In Jesus' holy and precious name, we pray. Everybody say, my heart's open. My mind's ready. Make me better, God. I'm open to whatever. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. So you said you're open to whatever. Just saying. You said it. You said it. Okay, so if you were hanging out with a friend after service who didn't go to church, and they were like, hey, so what'd you do this weekend? Super nice out, what'd you do? And you said, oh, I went to church. And they looked at you and said, what's a church? Just imagine that for a second. How would you define church? If they said, what's a church? How would you personally define what a church is or isn't? You know, I've heard some weird, weird stuff about what a church is and is not over the years. For real, man. Like, I like talked to a group of guys one time, like, hey, you know, well, like, for us, churches, you know, it's in the summer, you know, we just kind of head to the lake and we hang out as a group of believers, just enjoying each other's time at the lake. And is that a church? No, it's not a church. And other people are like, oh, you know, churches, I got a bunch of friends and we go hang out at the pub and we just kind of get together, you know, and we pray for each other and we read some scriptures and we study the word of God together as friends at the pub. Is that a church?
No.
No. It's not a church. It's not a church. And other people are like, oh, for me, church is, you just sit at home and like and you download some podcasts and then you get a bunch of worship music and you download that and you just worship your guts out and you listen to some great preaching. Is that a church? No, all three of those are believers hanging out at a lake, a pub, or at a home. But does that necessarily make it a church? Now, is God anti-lake? Is he anti-pub? Praise God. And is he anti your house? No, of course not. He's not anti any of that stuff, but that doesn't make it a church. We're talking about having church. What's a church? Now, at this point, some of you are like scrambling. Okay, if I could, like, Bible nerds are going, Bible verse, what am I going to think of? Like, what's a Bible verse that says this is what a church is? I'll give you the one that usually comes up. Usually what comes up is this one, is Matthew 28 or 18 verse 28. It goes this, where two or more are gathered, there I am. Who's heard that as the definition of a church before? Because see your hands. That verse is not talking about a church at all. You know what it's talking about? Relational dysfunction. It's about two believers. Read the passage all around it. It's about two people who are in an argument and they can't get along spiritually. They can't understand each other very well. And so Jesus says, get some other people, get two or three more, get them together and they'll help untangle this relational knot. And I will be in the middle of that. That Jesus is pro reconciliation of relationships. Is that good news? Yes, but that's not a church. That's two or three people in conflict. And Jesus says, I'll help you get your conflict solved. So, what then is a church? What then is like an actual church? You know, like, here's the thing. We talk about a church and what it is and what it is not. And then I start to realize many people, like, and this is just like, I'm just kind of throwing this out there because this is pretty normal. And at one point or another, I have used all the things I'm about ready to say. We ask ourselves all kinds of questions about whether or not we like our church. Or whether we like this church or that church, or maybe I'm gonna consider going to church. And so, like, we'll ask ourselves some really faulty questions about church and whether or not it's a good one. So, for example, these are the questions I usually hear. You can throw those on the screens. Do I feel something when I go there? So a good church is a place, if I go there and I feel something, you know, I feel the Spirit, I feel God, that's a good church. So what happens when you don't feel it? It's a bad church, right? So how's that work in a marriage? So I felt something for you, baby, so we got married. I don't feel nothing anymore, so I just quit. See, you can't judge a church on whether or not you're feeling it. Feelings are fickle. Come on, say it with me. Feelings are fickle. There's gonna be some days you're gonna be like, this place was smoking hot and awesome. Next day you're gonna be there like, that place sucked. It's just the reality of real church. It's never gonna be awesome sauce all the time. How about this one? What was my childhood church experience like? Some people say good churches are what I experienced as a child. So I went to Baptist churches as a child, therefore it's gotta be strict and boring. I grew up Baptist, I can say that. Some of you grew up Pentecostal, so church has gotta be filled with speaking in tongues and lots of that kind of, like some people are like, oh, like church for me, I grew up Catholic, therefore you gotta cross yourself, you gotta do the Hail Marys, you gotta make sure you take communion. That's what church is. But is any of this, does that make it actually right? Just because you experienced that as a child, does that make it so? Oh, that's the best way church should be because that's what I experienced. So your personal preference determines what a good church and a bad church is. Don't you think you might want to have something bigger than yourself to determine what a good church and a bad church is? You didn't make up church anyway. God did. How about this question? Do I like the preaching, the kids' stuff, and the music? That's the pretty normal one I think we hear for the most part today. If I like the preaching, and I like the kids' stuff, and I like the music, that's a good church. Just because you like them preaching doesn't necessarily make it true. Just because the kids had a happy time doesn't make it a healthy place for them to be. Huh. Oh, the music was smoking hot. That's where I go to church. What a dumb way to choose a church. Pastor Ted just said amen. There has to be something deeper and richer to our church experience than do I like the music and does the guy entertain me as he talks? Right? And then the last one, and it's just pretty typical. I hear, and we hear about this at our church a lot. Is it cool? No matter how hard we try to be cool, Hollywood's always cooler. They have bigger budgets, better lights, better sound, better guitarists. No offense, Ted. And the truth of the matter is, this is not as cool as going to an AC/DC show. It's just not. You can say, oh, my church is really cool. It's not cool to an unbeliever. It's still just church. So what is a better question? Everybody say better question. What's a better question to choose what a good church is and a bad church is than my feelings, my personal experience? Notice it's my, like you're God. Right? See, the church is about who? Jesus. So he gets to decide what a good church and a bad church is. Would you agree with that? Therefore, the better question would be this. What is the church according to the Bible? Jesus is called the Word. He's actually called the Word, that he is the Word of God. So he gets to define what a good church and a bad church is. And in fact, I'd even take it further. He's the one that says, I will build my what? Church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. He builds the church. He thought up the church. He started the church. It was his plan for the church. It's all about what Jesus says a good church is and is not a good church. Does that make sense? So what is a good church according to this book? Throw your feelings out for a second. Throw your friendships out for a second. Throw whether you like the music out for a second. What is a good church according to this book? And did you know that we already answered the question with the reading of the text? See, because Luke describes what a good church is in verses Acts 2:36-47. He very clearly gives you all these different distinctions of what a good church is, what a good healthy church is versus a cult, what a great church is versus a wackadoodle-doo church is. He gives you some very clear scriptural understanding of what good church is and what lousy church is. And all we're going to do tonight is we're going to walk through this passage. But to help you walk through the passage, I'm going to give you an acrostic. The acrostic is this, Jesus Church. Everybody say Jesus Church.
Jesus Church.
That literally, the church is whose?
Jesus.
It's Jesus' church. And so what I'm going to do for every letter of this acrostic, I'm just going to give you one thought from Acts chapter 2, 36 to 47, on what a good church is versus a bad church. And this is the part I want you to take some notes on, because if you could just, by the way, I didn't think up this acrostic. Somebody smarter than me, a better pastor than me, thought this deal up. This was so awesome. I was like, oh my gosh, this is brilliant teaching. And I own this, and you can judge the crossing on this. You can judge a church down the road. Don't judge other churches, just judge us. For real, you're sitting at our church, just judge us. Like, by the way, truth never fears a challenge. So we're not afraid if you judge us. See, we know what it means to be a church that's healthy and honorable to the kingdom of Jesus. And so what we're gonna do is we're gonna walk through this one little passage and you judge us as to whether, and by the way, if you're a part of this church, whose church is this? It's your, and judge yourself as to whether or not you're participating in a healthy church yourself. So don't just judge the church as a whole. Who's the church? Oh, you are. So judge whether or not you're actually participating in a healthy way or you're actually leading your own little cult. Whoa. Can we talk about it? Okay, it's going to be so much fun. Okay, so I'm just going to read Acts 2, for the first verses again. Here's how it starts. Acts 2. So let everyone in Israel know for certain that God has made this Jesus that you have crucified to be both Lord and Messiah. Peter's words pierced their hearts, and they said to him and the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? Peter replied, each of you must be, what? Must what? Repent of your sins and turn to God, and turn to God and be baptized in the name of? For the forgiveness of your? First thing you know about a good church versus a cult, or a good church versus a wackadoodle-do church, is it's Jesus worshiping. Come on, say Jesus worshiping. That the focus of the church is we worship Christ and not something else. When you walk in the doors of this place, do you feel like we worship Jesus? Is Jesus' name mentioned? Are we praying to Jesus? Are we talking about Jesus? Are we focused on Jesus? Are we focused on something else? That is the differentiation. Like, not whether or not we have lights or sound. Not whether or not that we have a great screen or cool music. The way you determine whether a church is good is whether Jesus is actually worshiped here. It was awesome, because I remember a few years ago, some people were like ripping on us or something for something or other. And so a friend of mine brought another friend to church, and he's like, I just wanted to bring him along and see what he thought of my church. And he got done, he's like, that's just church. They just worship Jesus there. And I was like, duh! That's what we do here. We worship Jesus. Now, I'll be even more specific. We are not label-focused, person-focused, or system-focused. What do I mean by that? We're not label-focused. The Baptists are the one that gave us the money to start the crossing. But we don't walk around talking about we're Baptists. How many of you ever heard me talk in our weekend service recently about the fact we're Baptist? It's never happened. The Baptists gave us the money to start, but we are not label focused. There's great churches focused on Jesus that are Lutheran, Presbyterian, Catholic, right? So we don't focus on a label. We also don't focus secondarily. Put that back on the screens. Where'd it go? Not person focused. In other words, who is the senior pastor of the Crossing Church? Not me. Somebody said Reuben is now, because he's the campus pastor. Are you the senior pastor of the Crossing Church, Reuben? No. Am I the senior pastor of the Crossing Church? No. Who is the senior pastor of the Crossing Church? Jesus Christ is. This is his church, and we do what he says, that we submit ourselves to the teachings and the ways of Christ alone. Everybody say Christ alone. That's a healthy church. When a church is about one person and what they want and their thing, and it's all about them, that's a wackadoodle-doo church. Third, we're not system-focused. In other words, this. Have you ever been to a church where it's like, okay, well, this is the way the denomination does it. We just got to do it like this. And like, this is the little box we have to function. God doesn't function in boxes. God blows up boxes. Like when he created the world, all of a sudden he was like, hey, let there be light. And bam, there was light. Where did light come from? Let's see if we can organize it. He just said, let there be light. And he blew up everybody's box scientifically. See, the reality is this. Every time you decide to put God in a box, God will seek to blow up your box because you tried to place him in something that he was never meant to be in. He's bigger, he's wiser, he's greater than you could ever be. So look at the person next to you and say, God wants to blow up your box. See, that's a healthy church when we say, hey, the church is a place where all of your little paradigms get blown up a little bit so you can build them on a better foundation, the word of God. Does that make sense? And then Luke goes on, Peter's preaching. He goes on and says this, Acts 2:38, then you will receive the gift of the?
Holy Spirit.
Letter E, embracing of the Spirit. Everybody say embrace the Spirit. Now there are two kinds of churches in our world, and we talked about it a little bit last week. This letter E stands for the fact that we never run from the Holy Spirit. Some people are like, oh, that speaking in tongues things is weird. Well, if God wants you to speak in tongues, embrace it. And if God wants to do a miracle and heal somebody else through your prayer, embrace it. Don't run from the power of the Spirit. Embrace the power of the Spirit. Because he may want to do something bigger than your little, normal little mindset. He wants to blow up suburbia and make something way more beautiful than what you could ever imagine. Now, you can write this down. Good churches do not ignore or run from the Holy Spirit. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6. Not by might, nor by power, but by my says the Lord of hosts. Now, I do want to say one thing. I'm going to throw one thing out here. When people ask what kind of church we are, I kind of say Baptist-costal. Because we agree with all of the gifts of the Spirit, but we started out as Baptists. So we almost said, what kind of church are you? We're Baptist-costal, I guess, in some sense of the word. We're kind of embracing of the Spirit of God and anything the Spirit of God wants to do. What I mean by that, though, is this. We are charismatics with a seatbelt. For real. Because sometimes people chase the gifts rather than the giver of the gifts. So if God wants you to give you a gift, embrace the gift, but don't just talk about the gift, talk about the giver of the gift. That we don't chase after signs and wonders and miracles and seeing if this thing could happen or that thing could happen. We're not chasing after miracles. We're chasing after Jesus, who might just do miracles. Do you see the distinction? That's a healthy church, embracing whatever God wants to do, but not getting so caught up in, hey, did something weird happen today? That's the only way it could be good. That's just weird, right? Every time the church meets doesn't mean there has to be a miracle, but there could be. We're open to one. Do you see the distinction? Acts 2:32 and following goes like this, 39 and 40. This promise is to you and to your children, and to those far away. It's to who? You and your children, those who are far away, and all those who call on the name of the Lord our God. Then Peter continued to preach for a long time. Amen. Strongly urging all his listeners. I just got to say that. Save yourselves from this crooked. What's the last word? Notice he's talking about generational ministry here. So letter S, serving all generations. Everybody say serving all generations. Meaning this, that we recognize the fact that a church cannot be for one generation. Then it's not a church. It's just a youth group. A youth group is not a church. It's a youth group. So if everybody at your church is 20, that's awesome that you're all 20, but you're not a church. You're a youth group. So you want a church that's got people who are 50, 60, 70, wiser than me. And then you want people who are 40, 30, 20, and 10. You want people of all generations to find a place where they can worship the God who is the God of every generation, the young, the old, and everyone in between. So when you look at the church, some people are like, oh, the Crossing Church is a young church. It has young musicians, and the pastors are old. She's really young. It's got young technology, but old theology. We seek to be a place that every generation can find a place to worship God, love Jesus, and live out their calling and gifts in Christ. Is that good news? That's a good church. That's a healthy church. See, a lot of times I think like a cool church tends to be just a place where I can find a mate. Like cool church can just be a place where everybody's single and we're just all looking for a spouse, which is awesome. I hope you, like, if you don't have one, look around. There's some great people here. They're single. I get you a date. But at the same time, you want a church to be where there's somebody older than that to mentor you to say, hey, avoid that chick. Walk away from that dude. Because there's some maturity in the midst. Does that make a sense? Next, Acts 2:41. Those who believed this, believe what Peter said, were baptized. Everybody say baptized. Baptized. And added the church that day about 3,000. How do you know 3,000 were added? Because they counted the baptisms. Yeah, they weren't just counting a crowd, they were counting the what? Baptisms. That's who the first church was, those who were baptized with a confession of faith. They said, I follow, letter U, understanding of baptism. We understand that to be a part of the local church, you can be a part of the crowd and not be baptized. You're welcome to be in the room, to worship, to serve, to be here as long as you want to be here, but the actual church are those who have been what? Baptized, and they follow Jesus. Some people say, oh, I can follow Jesus and not be baptized. What are you smoking? He said, follow me. And he followed up that with, hey, be baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Spirit. Go read the end of the book of Matthew. This is what it means to be a part of the local church. So you're either in this because you've been baptized. No, you don't have to just be baptized at this church. You can be baptized at any church, and then you're part of the body of Christ. Does that make sense? But an understanding of baptism. Our next baptism is June 26th. Somebody say June 26th. That is a lake baptism after the second service on Sunday. We're all headed out to BB Lake, and there'll be a big picnic. And if you'd like to get baptized, write a note on your Connect envelope or whatever, and drop or give it to Pastor Ruben in the front, who's the new campus. I'm just advertising Pastor Ruben all over the place. Like, is the new campus pastor for Elk River. Just say, hey, I want to get baptized, and we will dunk you on June 26th. Is that cool? Okay, Acts 2:42 goes on and says this. Remember, this is Peter preaching one message and Luke writing it down. All the believers devoted themselves. Everybody say devoted. Devoted themselves to what? To what? The apostles' teaching. So S would be scripture-based. Everybody say scripture-based. That they devoted themselves to the word of God. Good churches, write this down, believe and teach the whole Bible. Believe and teach the whole what? The whole Bible. We don't get to say what parts we disagree with. We teach the whole thing. Now, here's the thing. I'm going to be super honest. Ready? Super honest. We don't understand the whole thing. That would be arrogance to say such a thing. It would be, if you ever hear somebody say, we understand the whole Bible, run away from them. They don't know what they are talking about. Nobody understands the whole Bible except Jesus, who wrote it. But here's what we can say. This is how humility comes into the picture. We are all just learners seeking to understand from Jesus what his word says, including the pastors, that we're just learners. If we ever start saying we're the experts, man, that's a bad place to be. We are not the experts on the word of God. We are just learners trying to say, this is what we know. This is what God's taught us. Maybe this could help you too. That's it. And here's the thing. In 11 years of doing this, man, I disagree with myself from like 6 years ago. As you grow, you learn new stuff. You disagree with yourself in the past and you change for the future, change for the better. Is that making sense? That's a healthy church, a church that's willing to change. Sometimes people will say to me, Pastor, why can't you preach like you used to preach? And I would say, because I'm not that guy anymore. Jesus changed me and made me a better human being. You don't want me to preach like that guy anymore. That guy was whack. This guy is still whack, but doing a little better in the body of Christ. Does that make sense? Acts 2:42, and this is what he says next. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship. Everybody say coordinated ministry. Now, as soon as we use the word coordinated ministry, that's not what fellowship means to you all. Like if you grew up Lutheran in the state of Minnesota, what does fellowship mean? It means a potluck. It means food. It means when do we eat? But that's not what the word fellowship actually means. See, I want you to write this down because it's super important. They devoted themselves to fellowship, and it has nothing to do with eating food. Well, it could include eating food, but that's not the primary point. The word fellowship is the word koinonia. Who's ever heard that word before? Can I see your hands? It's a churchy word, koinonia. Okay, it's a kind of a word that people throw out all the time. But what maybe you don't know is koinonia actually has this connotation, a pair of oxen pulling together. It's two oxen harnessed up side by side to accomplish a purpose, to accomplish a mission. So does that mean fellowship is a place where you just hang out and eat food? No. It is so much more than that. It is so much deeper than that. It's so much richer than that. Fellowship is a place where you're like, hey, there's a harness here. There's a spot for me. There's a place for me in this deal, and I get to harness up next to somebody else, and we get to accomplish a mission for God. So here's my question. Are you just sitting around eating food, or are you actually accomplishing a mission? Now, here's the thing. There are times and seasons, everybody say seasons, where the best thing for you is just to eat some food because you don't want starving oxen pulling something. Would you agree with that? So you have to analyze. When you hear me say something like that, that doesn't mean don't analyze your life. There are seasons in which the best thing for you is to sit and eat and study the word of God and grow up so you can be strong enough to go out and serve. But the goal of the church is that you would partner up, that there's a place here for you. Look at the person next to you and say, there's a place for you to serve here. So the note I wrote on there was, all people have a place to serve and honor Jesus. So are you finding your place? Have you found it yet? If you haven't, once again, go see Pastor Ruben. Or just fill out your Connect envelope or go talk to a section leader in the front. Where are the section leaders at? Wave your hands. Like, okay, talk to a section leader after service and say, hey, I want to find a place to serve. I just can't figure out where. I don't know what my deal is. I don't know how to, like, how do I participate in this? But the goal of a good church is to find everyone a place to serve. Everybody say everyone. So there's not a place where the majority of people are sitting around. The majority of people are finding a place to serve Christ. And then Luke goes on, Acts 2, 42 and 43, and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper. Oh, look, then now you get some food. Everybody say amen. Amen. Amen, I get to go eat after service. Yes, and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's what? Supper or communion, which we're going to talk about that in a little bit. We'll do that at the end of the service. And to prayer and a deep sense of. So there was communion, there was prayer, and there was an emotional sense of awe. You know, earlier I said you can't judge a church by whether or not you're feeling it. There still is a moment in some point or another where there's some emotions involved. Emotions aren't bad. A deep sense of awe came over all of them, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and what? Wonders. But once again, we don't seek the wonders. We seek who? Jesus, who then performs wonders as he pleases. So this is letter H, heartfelt worship. Everybody say heartfelt worship. Not just ritualistic or unemotional. Not just ritualistic or unemotional. And I think a lot of times people kind of go through the motions after they've been at a church for a while. They go through the motions of worship rather than actually worshiping. And what God is after when you come to the house of God is, oh my gosh, that there is heart and head and body all involved. That the holistic part of you, every part of you, is engaged in the worship of Jesus. Now here's the thing. What does worship look like? When you think of worship, what do you think of? Somebody said it. What did they say? Music. But is that all that Christian worship is? No, I'm going to give you three things, three aspects of Christian worship. Aspects of Christian worship. Communion, prayer, and singing. Everybody say communion, prayer, and singing. So here's the thing. A healthy church or a healthy church goer is devoted to, when are we going to take communion? And when the communion thing happens, I'm going to be in the house of God because that's a big deal. It's amazing to me the number of people that I have talked to over the years that have prayed before communion and they've been dealing with an issue. They took the communion and God did a miracle right there on the spot. This is my own little weird analogy, but just like you take meds sometimes to physically make yourself better, I kind of look at the spiritual man, the spiritual part of you is participating in communion keeps yourself spiritually healthy. It's reminding you that what matters most is the cross. What matters most is Jesus. Jesus is the focus and the center of my life. And when your worship is on Christ, Jesus does miracles. Communion. Secondarily, prayer. So when you come to worship, do you start with prayer, you personally? Not did the pastor pray, but did you pray? Where in the service did you go, you know, oh, I need to stop for a second. I just need to pray. Or did you just show up? See, because this place will only be as healthy as the prayers that are going up. Showing up doesn't make a church healthy. Praying up will make a church healthy. Right? And lastly, let's not forget singing. And this is awesome because Pastor Ted and Mackenzie, don't they do an awesome job? Jamie, you, wherever you're at in here, you do a great job. Like seriously, there's so many great musicians and vocalists at this church. But here's the struggle. Church was never designed to be a place where you observe somebody else worshiping. See, they are worshiping on this stage. But if, guys, this is how men tend to worship. I have to do this for 10 minutes, 'cause that's how long worship goes. For real. And here's the thing. Some of you are like, oh, but I just don't feel it. Or I'm uncomfortable making any sort of movement. Like, what do I do with my hands? It's like directing traffic. What am I doing here? And so it's true. I remember when I went from this to this and how uncomfortable it was at first. Who's ever done that? Like, yeah, it's uncomfortable at first. So I think it's awesome that God actually included a Bible verse about this in Scripture. He's talking directly to men. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8. He says, in every place of worship, I want men. And it's not the word mankind. It's literally the word male. Why? Because he knows dudes are less emotional than women. Dudes tend to be the most stoic in the room. So I want males to pray with holy hands. What's the next two words? Lift it up. That this is how you approach church. That for it to be healthy, that you are actively participating with all that is you. And that doesn't mean you gotta like slap your neighbor and like and do smell your pits before you do that. I'm just messing, but seriously, like be free with your worship. That's a good church. When you see a church that has people participating, that's a good church. Now, here's the thing I always tell our band and stuff. If half the crowd isn't participating, that's a good week. That means half the crowd isn't believers yet. If everybody in the room is participating, when we have a leaders meeting, we call them COL, the whole place, it's a community of leaders meeting, the whole place is all electric in worship. Why? Because they're all the leaders of the church, all getting together for worship, and they're all in. So there's so much passion. But if every service is like that, then we're probably not reaching anybody anymore. So a good church is a place with heartfelt, everybody say heartfelt worship. He goes on and says this, Acts 2:44 and 45, and all the believers met together in what? And shared everything they had. What? When's the last time you shared everything you had? They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with all those in. So letter U is uncommon generosity. Everybody say uncommon generosity. That a healthy church is a place where people naturally want to be givers. That the offering is not something, like people are like, the offering is just trying to take their money. No, the offering reveals the heart of a church. It reveals the heart of the people in the church. Because a place that is healthy has uncommon generosity in the middle of it. You're like, oh my gosh, I want to give. I want to participate in this. I want to bless somebody else. After service, I'm gonna take this person out and buy that, like whatever that looks like. You see somebody walking around with holes in their shoes, you're buying them shoes. Like you're just thinking, how can I be a person of generosity? The world is not generous. What the difference is between the world and the church, one of our marks is we are as generous as Jesus. How generous was Jesus? He gave it all. He gave it all. So when you look at your church, is it a place of generosity? Are people willing to give, excited about giving? Is it cheerfully given? That's a healthy church. Acts 2:46 goes on and says this, they worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper. Notice they worshiped together when? Every day. I'm gonna say every day. They met in their homes for the Lord's Supper, so that's in the evening. They met a second time in the evening and shared their meals with great joy and generosity. Apparently, the meal thing was still a big deal, so apparently the Lutherans are cool. So they shared their meals with great joy and what? Lastly, generosity. So this is regular meetings. Everybody say regular meetings. And we talked about this a lot last week. We said that in order to be a healthy church, you have to meet on a regular basis. In order to be a healthy Christian, then, you have to meet regularly. Look at the person next to you and say, are you regular? Yes. Yes, you're spiritual Metamucil. Just come into the house of God. You'll just purge some stuff you didn't want in there anymore. Right? Okay, Ted, you're not allowed to laugh because it encourages me. Are you with me so far, though? So one of the things we talked about last week is the old school churches tend to want to guilt you into attending a worship service. We never want to guilt you into coming to the house of the body of Christ. We want to reward you because, I'll be honest, the book of Hebrews says God rewards those who diligently seek him. God is the rewarder of those. So that's why we're talking about, hey, if you just show up for the 4 weeks of the Havin Church Series, we'll enter you in a drawing for the Valley Fair deal. If you show up, guys, 9 of 11 weekends that we're gonna do we're gonna invest in your spiritual health because you invested in your spiritual health. And in the month of August, we're gonna take all those men that have participated for those 9 weeks. And remember something else on a trip. But here's the thing. Remember that men, I want you to hear this again. I said it last week. But statistics say this, that for 85% of the time, if a guy in the house will go to church, the rest of the family will follow. If the dude will go, the rest of the family will follow. If the wife in the house goes, this is just stats. It's not because women are less than or anything. It's just a stat. That's all it is. If a woman chooses to go to the body of Christ, to go to church, the men and the rest of the house follow only 15 to 20% of the time. And it's not because women are less than. It's not the reason. There's just something, I don't know why this is the case, outside of the fact that you know it. We see a lot more ladies coming to the house of God and their husbands don't want to come than we do a bunch of dudes coming and their wives stay home. Does that make sense? And so that's just I'm just being pragmatic about it. Guys, your family will be as healthy as you're participating in worship. Now, one of the things he says is they met every day. Now, do we have to meet every day? Yes or no? No, we don't have to meet every day. But I would say if you're just meeting whenever you feel like it, is that a regular meeting? No. You're gonna have to make a habit out of it. So I want you to write this down, large and small connection points. Large and small connection points. So they had a large group meeting. This is why earlier when somebody said, like we were talking about, like, well, my church is meeting at a pub, hanging out and reading scripture. That's great, but that's a small connection point. To be a healthy church, you also need a large group gathering. They met in a large group. They met at the temple every day. How many people? 3,000. Do you think a city would notice if 3,000 people showed up there every morning at 6? Yeah, that might make an impact. And so God's like, hey, meet consistently in a large group and then a small group. It's not a church to just hang out in your house. It's really hard to invite your unbelieving friends to go do church in your house, right? It's just the truth. Can you make a greater impact coming to a large group gathering? Yes. It's less threatening. They can hide in the crowd. They don't have to like know anybody until they're ready to. They can ask the questions they want to ask to whoever they want to ask and not feel like they're being pointed out. It matters so much. Large and small connection points. And then we'll go on. Acts 2:47 goes on and says this, and all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill. Everybody say goodwill. Goodwill of all the people. This is letter C, cheerful experience. Everybody say cheerful. If the church that you participate in doesn't know how to have fun, run, Forrest, run. If they don't enjoy themselves, if they can't have a good time, run away. You want to be a part of a church that doesn't shut down cheer. If it shuts down cheer, run away. Like, some weeks I'll be funny in here. Some weeks I'm really straight up. Some weeks I'm stern. Some weeks I'm happy. But here's the reality. You want an overall experience that leaves you with less guilt and more joy because Jesus took away your guilt at the cross and gave you freedom and strength to serve him. That's what you're after in the body of Christ. So basically this, a good church. God is good and his people experience joy. Everybody say, God is good and his people experience joy. Now, sometimes you're gonna come in here and you're not full of joy. I get it. Sometimes I come in here and I'm not full of joy. But together, when you get around other people who have a positive spirit, what happens to your spirit? It's lifted. That's why scripture says to carry each other's burdens. You meet together because your weeks are hard and sometimes life is rough and you walk in here holding on to all this weight and all this burden. Sometimes you did it to yourself. Sometimes other people do it. Sometimes it's just the circumstances you're in and you come in with this big old load of stuff. And when you get around somebody else and they say, hey, how about I pray for you? How about I hold you up in prayer? How about I encourage your heart? How about we have a conversation? How about we point you to Jesus? All of a sudden your burdens are less. And you start to notice your blessings a little more. Is that good news, church? That's why we meet, man. And then lastly, Acts 2:47b, and each day the Lord added, everybody say added. Added to their fellowship. And by the way, many translations don't use the word fellowship here because that's that word koinonia again. Two oxen hooked up on a mission. Many translations just use the word church because a church is about two oxen or two people, a group of believers hooked up on a mission. Everybody say mission. And so each day the Lord added to their group mission those who were being saved. So lastly, habitual outreach. Habitual outreach. This is really important. sometimes people start to think that church is a place for believers. And then we go out into the world and we reach unbelievers. But why does it have to be an either or? Why can't it be both? Why can't the church be a place for believers? And then the Lord added daily those who are being saved. That there's always a space, there's always an empty chair, there's always an extra seat, there's always something available for somebody who doesn't know yet what they believe or what they think, and maybe they're agnostic, maybe they're atheist, maybe they're just discouraged, maybe they lost their faith. Wherever they're at, there always is a seat for them to come sit and process at their own pace. And the Lord adds daily. Who adds? The Lord. We don't got to twist anybody's arm or shove anything down anybody's throat. The Lord just adds. We don't got to judge people for what they're, like, by the way, don't judge a non-Christian for non-Christian behavior. Why are we judging unbelievers for acting like unbelievers? Right? Do they have the Spirit of God in them? So stop trying to make them clean up their actions. Just tell them Jesus loves them. Just be good to them. Just pray over them. Just bless them. Just encourage them. That's all we got to do here. And the Lord will add daily those who are being saved. He'll take care of that. He'll grow the church. Whose church is it? His church. So lastly, good churches reach out daily to those who have never experienced grace. Everybody say grace. What is grace again? God is for you, not against you. He's so for you that he sacrificed his son on your behalf. Every day when you wake up, he's saying, I know the number of hairs on your head. I've collected your tears in a bottle. I've got strength for you today. Just turn to me. I've got hope for you today. Just trust me. I can fill you with wisdom and discernment and strength and growth. Just don't quit on your faith. Last night, Kelly and I and Pastor Jason and Tracy went to a St. Paul Saints game. That place is awesome. It's way more interesting than the Twins, by the way. I still only got through the fifth inning and I couldn't do it anymore. I had to leave. I got bored. Like, it's just me. It's as long as I can sit there. I don't know how I do church, but apparently I like it. See, Spirit of God. And so we're at the game, and my daughter had wanted to go to the game, and so my daughter and son had got there late, and so we went to get them tickets, but there wasn't anything left. So we could pay $9 and have them stand in the commons area and try to watch the game. And it was like, they're like, we don't want to stand, Dad. We want to seats. I'm like, there's no seats left. What are you going to do? And they said, we'll just go to Starbucks. So Holland and Aiden went off to Starbucks with a friend, and they get over to Starbucks. And partway through the game, we get this text message from my daughter. And she's like, oh my gosh, I just spent the last 20 minutes trying to lead this old guy to Jesus. It was super cute. And then she comes home later on in the evening, and she tells this whole story about, like, how she had just shared the gospel for like a long time, and they had this huge conversation, and this husband and wife were trying to tell them what, like, back and forth, and like, and at the end of the conversation, like so they got into it because basically they were in a conversation about politics. I don't even know how that started. And then at one point Holland says, well, this is what I believe because I'm a Christian. And as soon as she said that, then they got in a conversation about Jesus. She was just really vocal and open about it. And she didn't lead this guy who's in his 60s, she said, to Christ. But she had like a 20-minute conversation as a 15-year-old saying, trust Jesus, follow Jesus, worship Jesus. And that's how you know a good church. Are the people in the church vocal about their faith? Are they caring enough to help somebody else want to know, like with the gospel story? See, I always, one of the things, I'll just throw this out, this is like personal preference. I know a lot of pastors, I know a lot of mega church pastors, like I've been friends with a lot of them over the years, and I know the good ones from the bad ones. You know how I know? I look at their kids. Just throwing that out there. Just look at their kids. And if their kids are healthy and loving Jesus and following Jesus and promoting Jesus and caring about Jesus, if they can lead their families well, they can lead a church well. And so when you walk in the doors of a church, Don't judge it based on your past experience or what you feel. Judge it based on what the scriptures teach. And it's so clear in Acts 2 what a healthy church is. And then God looks at you and say, will you join him at his church? It'll be healthier if you're here. We're going to participate in communion in just a second. Kelly's going to come and lead you. We want to end all 4 weeks of this series in communion. But first, I just want to pray for you. Jesus, we thank you that you've called us to have in church. It's not a ritual. It's not just a tradition. It matters to you. We worship you. We seek you. We love you. I pray that every life walks out of here with their burdens lifted. Holy Spirit of God, free people from addictions right now in the name of Jesus. Restore marriages. Heal broken relationships. Inspire people with new ideas and fresh direction and new strength. And God, whatever you do, use your church. This is your church. We believe this local church is the only hope in all the world because it offers you. May you use us to reach another life with the gospel. In Jesus' name we pray, everybody said, amen.
Amen.